Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we will be performing a join and dealing with dates using Python and Postgres. The code will be linked in the description below. The purpose and outcome today will be to create a new table with a schema that will be used for our join. We will perform an inner join today and show a few examples of what could go wrong. Finally, we will make a query by date and show a few examples of that. I am not showing today the init or config file for creation that was in the previous video and will be linked above. Okay. What I do want to mention actually is that within the config file, you're creating key value pairs here, which will basically be your host, what your database is, your user, your password, etc. Right? So you will need psycopg2, pandas, numpy, and then if you create the config files, then you'll call that in here. This is basically what I called it, and this is the function that I had, and that's what's going here, where I'm making my connection with psycopg2, and then I'm calling in all my key value pair parameters. That's what's going on with this. Then we need to make a connection where we're creating a cursor so we can execute Postgres. And then I did auto commit equals true here, so you can basically, after you perform each of your operations, it happens immediately. Sometimes this isn't wanted. I use the data set that we've used a few times where we have our fake users, and I had to just basically store without an index column because that was messing me up. I didn't pay attention. So what I decided to do here is skip this part because it's the actual formation of our fake data set and get into what we're doing. So this will be our join table that we're going to use. So I created a credit card, a fake CPU, and a purchase date. So what we're going to do is do a join on credit card numbers. Okay, so I created a two separate tables. So if you don't remember from last time, I do a function where my parameter that I'm calling will be the cursor. So I'm saying cursor.execute, and then if this table exists, drop it. Then let's create this table, which will be called staging fake CPU purchases, where I'm creating a primary key, which is the credit card, and everything will be a text. So the credit card CPU and purchase are text, where the purchase is a date and it cannot be null. Then I created the fake people table, did the same thing, where I have now the credit card, email, first name, last name, and phone number. Okay, and then if you notice this right here, you're taking your connection cursor and you're saying as cursor, use that function and place the information from that function in there and send your schema to Postgres. Okay, then what I needed to do was send some fake CPU purchases to Postgres. So like we did in the last video where we took a CSV file and we're sending it into Postgres so we could store that information. I'm not going over that. That was part of the last video, and we're going to skip to where we could start querying and seeing how this join works. All right, so just to do a simple join so you see what these data look like for this, the fake people table, we have a credit card, we have an email, we have the I guess that's the first name, the last name, and then this is their fake phone number. Okay, then to look at the CPU purchases. We have a date, we have the fake CPU they purchase, and then we have the credit card number. Now, since we're doing an inner join, remember we're basically looking at the column, lets, and common between both tables and putting them together. So this is what it basically looks like. So we're saying, let's select the CPU purchases, and let's take everything there, and let's take everything from the people, one, and it's taking it all, but this is a little distinction. You're going to see what's going on there. And we're saying from the CPU purchases, this inner join with the fake people, and you're merging these on, or joining these on the credit card, where you say staging.creditcard. Then you say staging.creditcard, right? So that's what's going on. And then if you noticed here, it's a little bit different. And you say, well, what's really going on with this? Well, it looks the same, doesn't it? Well, it's a little different. And let's look at what the output. Let's look at what the output will be. Okay. So we're going to look at this in the terminal and also here. So here we're saying, let's select everything with all of the information, and it's printed out. Well, you see here there's a credit card and it's a duplicate. And you say, oh no. No. What's going on here? This looks odd, right? Well, let's go in here first and let's back up to the last example and see what goes on. Okay, so let's do that query again, but let's do a limit on there. There. So we say, let's limit this, but if you notice here, that whole table of staging fake people turns out to be, you know, basically a like a list right here. It's not divided, right? So you have to pay attention. And what happened there? Well, this distinction right here, because when I use this, everything was broke up on that table, but when I excluded it, this is the output. Okay. Well, then what's with this first example right here then? Well, let's find out. So let's go and copy everything. And we can see what the output is here, but let's actually see what the terminal output looks like for a visual representation to kind of help you out. And if you notice, you have two credit card columns. And that's not exactly desirable. It's the correct output. But why do I have this? And maybe your boss is like, hey, let's join these two tables and figure out what's going on with the purchases. And then you put it together and you say, oh man, this sucks because now I have two credit card duplicates. Okay. So here, I rectified the issue where I used the dot star and it broke up all of the columns. But I now have duplicate columns. So then how do I deal with that? Okay. This is the first example from inside the markdown file where you have it printing this all off. All right. Now to finally rectify and fix this, what we have to do is instead of calling everything for both tables, the second table for the CPU purchases, we only want to take the CPU, so you do dot CPU, and dot purchase date. And then everything else looks the same pretty much. So you have only one credit card, and then everything else prints off right now. So that's what you want. So let's get a little bit better representation inside the terminal and see. Oops, let's just print off a couple of them. So then here we go. There's your one credit card column and everything else you wanted. Perfect. That's what you would want as your output. Okay. Then what we need to do is say, after we do select everything from the fake people and only the CPU and the purchase date from the CPU table interjoin the fake people table on each of these credit cards, dot credit card equals the fake purchases dot credit card. So you have to make sure you put equals right here and not a comma or something like that. That's one thing you need to remember. Okay, so after we create that, let's do something kind of cool. What if I want to expand these data and say, I just did a join, but I also want to store this as a table because this is something that comes up often maybe. Maybe you're always looking at purchasing behavior. And now you have two options. You can either create a temporary table, and that temp table, each time you exit Postgres, it'll disappear. Or if this is something that you actually need often, and it's something you should store, you could just create a new table from your join. But you could do it from a temp or as a permanent table. It just depends on what you need. Do you need to store an actual copy or not? So we say, let's do like our usual create a table, where we say create a table. Now the new table name I'm creating is people, PPL, CPU purchases. And then I say as, and then select, and the same thing that we did before, above. So you take that and it creates your new table, okay? Which is awesome. So let's scroll down a little bit. Okay, the interesting thing here is that we didn't have to create our schema like we did before. We're just using this directly from the tables that we have already, and it must be taking the stored information and allowing us a shortcut to create our own table. Okay, so let's go in here, and since I already have, I could show you, I already have this table, but let's drop that table. Okay, so I don't have it, so I already dropped it. Okay, so let's create that table now. What's going on here then? Oh, okay, I didn't pay attention. S, drop the table. Now, let's create that table again. Okay, we can verify. Now we have it again. Then we say, let's run a query on it. And here's the query. Let me show you what it looks like in the terminal real quick, so you can actually see the column names. And there we go. Now we have our new table that we stored the information from our join, which is really cool and useful. So now you have everything together. Perfect. Now let's expand this a little bit more. Since we have this, now we could do some queries by date range. Let's assume that you're a company and you deal with people's purchases, people's returns, and you have to do queries on those. And that's where this would actually be very beneficial. Okay? So then we say this query by date. So I say, let's select the first name and the last name, and we're taking today's date and we're subtracting all the purchase dates from that column, and we're calling a new column as diff. It's just a generic name from an example that I saw online. Then I say, let's take it from our people purchases table. And here's one example. So I'm having the first name and the last name, and that purchase as of today is 209 days old. Well, this is really useful. Let's say you have a 90-day return policy, all right? And this person was calling in and you had their first name and their last name. and then you run this information, and you could find out if their purchase is too old or not for a return or a warranty or any other kind of analytics that you'd be interested in. Then we could also filter between date ranges. And then we're saying, let's take everything that's between May 1st of 2019 and today. Okay? And we're just selecting everything. And here's one of the outputs. Okay? So we can go here. And you could, if you feel more comfortable seeing it in a table view, let's do that. And there we are. So here's specific items that or purchases that happened within this date range. And these are the first four that popped up. Then I could say, well, then let's look at specific purchases that happened in the last 10 days. So I say, let's select everything from the CPU purchases where our purchase column, our purchase date column is greater, the greater than symbol, than today's date minus an interval of 10 days. And that's the notation you do here. And this is your output. Okay? So that's very useful too. So we can look at this as well as in Postgres, so you know it all works. So let's go in here. And here's everybody that happened in the last 10 days. Here's March 21st, etc. I mean, May. So those are some very useful queries. I'd like to say thank you for watching. And as always, please subscribe, and if you do, turn on that notification bell and leave me a like if you thought that this was a useful video. If not, throw me a comment and tell me why, so I can make this channel better for the for all of us. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.